All right, Harvest Cathedral, how's it going today? Yeah. It is good to be here this morning. I love getting to worship with you. I get that opportunity. I don't know, they let me do it like, feels like once every other year, maybe. I love coming down here. It's such a beautiful place to worship God and to look around this building and to think what it was used for and to think what we are using it for now, for the worship of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, the one who we've gathered to lift high. And when I think of this building, I think of a couple different scenarios, a couple different stories. One's a highlight, one's a low light. So the highlight, I would say, is in 2012, we came here and we recorded the first album of what would become Vertical Worship. And just to think of God's faithfulness and all the things that he's done, all the doors that he's opened, all the things he's used that music to bless the church. And I remember I was sitting right here. I was playing the second set of keyboards. And there was this ginormous light behind me that was so hot, I think I got a sunburn on the back of my head. And I was wearing this like faux leather jacket. Man, a lot's happened since 2012. lots been happening since then. But so that was a highlight. It was awesome to be here for that. And then a low light was a few years ago, I came here to lead for a Christmas service. So it was in the month of December, mid-December. And on Saturday night, the heater of this building breaks. So then we show up at rehearsal at 7 a.m. and it's like, I don't know, it's like 40 degrees inside. So in here it was 40 degrees, and so if you were here, you remember that, because as we were worshiping the Lord, you saw a cloud of like vapor, right? Like rise up as we were singing to God. And I'd never done that before. I'd never worshiped God in such low temperatures and with numb fingers trying to play a guitar. But today, hey, the temperature's pretty nice. I would say it's relatively pleasant. So thankful to be here. Thankful to be here at this campus and appreciate the opportunity that I have today, because today I have a different job. Normally I come here and I lead worship, but I understand that that's not my job today. I have the job that Paul gave Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 2, where he said, preach the word. Preach the word. That's my job here this morning. Preach the word. To preach means to herald the message of the king. So it is my job to bring to you the message that God has given us and preach what? The word. It's God's word, the words of God that I hope are in your hands right now. And if you don't have a copy of God's word, you can find a copy under the seat in front of you. I want everyone to have this. Why? Because this is who we want to hear from. I don't want you to gather here today to hear from my ideas. I've come today to hear from God. And the only way we're going to hear from God is if we dive into his word. And that is why today my job is very clear. I have to preach the word. It's not like I'm a speech writer for the king. That's not my job, because the speech has already been written. My job is to herald the message of the king. Why? Well, Psalm 19 tells us that the law of the Lord is perfect. You get what that means? Like, there's nothing I can do to make this better for you. I can't do anything. It's absolutely perfect in every way, because the law of the Lord is perfect. And then it says this, reviving the soul. It revives your soul. And I don't know about you, but I want that. I want that today. I want to walk out of this building having a sense of newness in my heart and my soul, that you would be refreshed by what? By the law of the Lord and how it is perfect. And so that's what we're after today. If I haven't had the privilege of meeting you, my name is Eddie Hoagland. I serve now as the lead pastor of worship and production. It just means I oversee the worship and production departments across all our campuses. And I am thankful for this opportunity to share God's word with you, and that I want to talk about worship. No surprise there, obviously, since I'm a worship leader. But I want to talk about worship. To worship God means to ascribe worth to him. So when we gather today, everything that we do here ultimately is for that purpose. So the reason we sang these songs, the reason these people played these instruments, the reason we gave of our tithes and offerings, it's because we're saying something to God with all those actions. We're ascribing worth to him, saying, God, trusting you with 90% of my income, it's an ascription of worth, saying, I believe the things that you have said. And now together we stand under the authority of God's word. Why? Because we're ascribing this to him, that everything he says is true. What he has decreed will come to pass. We believe what God has said, and that is worship. We're ascribing it to him. And I just got to tell you, I've had to grow as a worshiper the past few months. I've had to grow in that, because I have to now put into action many things I've sung to God. And now God's like, all right, now live it. You've said this for many years. Now, will you do what is required of saying those words? And I've had to grow as a worshiper. And if we were to be able to rewind, I don't know, 7 months. Let's say we could go back to January of 2019. And you said, Eddie, here's what the next 7 months of your life are going to look like. And if you could just show that to me, I would have been like, yeah, no thanks. I'll take a pass on that one. And it's been hard. There's no way around it. 2019 has been a hard year, not only with what's going on here at our church, but also things that are happening in my family, things that have happened to my friends. I mean, it's just, I've never seen anything like 2019. And maybe that's you, or maybe if 2019 is not that way for you, you can think of a year where it was that way for you, where you're just like, man, what is going on this year? It's just hard. It's just difficult. And I remember a few months ago, and probably one of the hardest days I was having during the week, I was just at home. We had put the kids down, and I'm sitting in the living room with my wife, Christina, and I'm just telling her, man, babe, I don't think I can do this anymore. Like, I just don't think I can. I don't think I'm strong enough. I don't think I'm going to be able to make it through all the things that God is calling me to do. And praise the Lord for a godly wife who looked at me and said, you're right. You can't do this. But God can. God can give you that strength. And instead of spending all the time thinking about what you need, what if you went to the one who could give you what you need? What if you spent time talking to him? And I stand here now giving testimony to you that I have seen that to be true week after week after week, that God has given me the strength to walk into a meeting. Hey, I don't really want to walk into that meeting, God, but God's like, I've called you to that meeting. You go into that meeting, and I will give you what you need. My grace is sufficient for you. And then I look at a phone call, and I'm like, I don't really want to pick up this phone call. And God's like, I've called you to this. I have a reason. There's a thing, and I will give you the strength that you need to answer that phone call. And God is good. God is faithful. No matter how we fail, God remains faithful. And it's been in these times of worship where I've sensed my soul be refreshed. I've had kind of, it's like my lifeline. Like every week, no matter what goes on, like I come to church and then we get to lift high the name of Jesus together. And I'm telling you, that's where my heart finds rest. It's my safe place. And God's had to grow me as a worshiper in these past few months. So we're going to dive into God's word together. But before that, let me just pray for us. Father, we are so thankful to be your children. Who are we that you are mindful of us? Like, what have we done to deserve the fact that you would even think about us? And yet you do. And you love us. And we get to love you because you first loved us. And your love is perfect love. Your love is unconditional love. So God, we're thankful for who we get to be as your children. And we're just asking that you would meet us here, that as we dive into your word, that we would hear from you. God, help me to be faithful to this text that we'll be studying, knowing that you are the one who changes hearts. Holy Spirit, we invite that. Would you change us here today? We invite you into this place, and it's in the name of Jesus Christ we pray. All God's people said, amen. All right, 2 Samuel chapter 24. 2 Samuel chapter 24, that's where we're going to be spending the bulk of this message. But before we go there, I need to tell you why we're headed there. The why is actually comes from Romans chapter 12, verse 1, which I have this verse on the screen. It says, I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. So here Paul is giving us some new language in regards to a sacrifice. So when you think of an altar or you think of a sacrifice, like we would have never heard the term living sacrifice because that's an oxymoron, right? Like if an animal is being offered up as a sacrifice, as the fire consumes it, animal no longer alive. And yet here Paul is saying, you are supposed to be the sacrifice, but a living sacrifice. That the behavior you have would be sacrificial, and yet it wouldn't be in death that you show it, but it would be in life that you demonstrate it. That the behavior of sacrifice would be in the way that you live, the things that you do, that we would be a living sacrifice. And he says this, holy and acceptable to God. Holy, what does it mean to be holy? Holy means to be set apart, not like the rest, to be on the side. Why? Because God has set you apart and you are holy. If you are a child of God, you are holy because God has made you holy. God has declared you to be holy. He is the one who has set you apart. And if you have turned away from your sins and embraced Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, God says you're holy. He makes you holy. You're not like the rest. And not only that, but notice he says acceptable to God. Jesus Christ makes you acceptable to God. And as he's declared you to be acceptable, it not only stops there, but then he walks you through the process of giving God the things that he has requested. That's how he makes you acceptable. Because to be acceptable to God means that God will receive the things he's requested. And this is the awesome thing, that as God changes your life, he not just does it in a moment, but then he keeps changing you into the things that he wants you to be. And then he says, which is what? It's your spiritual worship. Your spiritual worship. So we're not even talking about something physical. So when we think of this altar that's being described here of a living sacrifice, it's a spiritual matter. It's not a physical matter. And that's what I want to talk to you about today. Building an altar of worship. Building an altar of worship. And I got to say, I'm not an altar builder myself, so we got to go to someone else to learn what are we even talking about here. I don't even know how to build an altar. Well, thankfully, within God's word, we have 2 Samuel chapter 24, and we're going to go and study from David how he built an altar and what are the things we can learn as we seek to build our altar of worship to God. So 2 Samuel chapter 24, I'm going to give you just a little bit of context, and then we're going to dive in at verse 18. We're going to study God's word from verse 18 all the way through the end of the book. Which is just a few verses, don't be afraid. So we're going to start right there in verse 18, but I got to give you a little bit of context. Here's what's going on. So at the beginning of the chapter, David sins against the Lord by sending Joab to complete a census. And at first glance, like when I started studying this passage, I thought, like, what's the big deal? Like, why is that sin? Well, few thoughts on that. One, we know it's sin because David knows it's sin. Within the passage, you'll see that David acknowledges that it's sin. He sins against the Lord. But I also see two things in there. One is that David didn't complete the census in the right way, because when you study the parallel passage in 1 Chronicles chapter 21, you find out that they left out two of the tribes. So they didn't even complete the census in the right way. But I think more importantly, it shows that David wasn't relying upon the Lord and wanted to rely upon what he could see with these eyes instead of what he could see with these eyes. And David started acting like what a Near Eastern king would have been acting in this time period, counting his armies as a sign of strength, and not acting like an Israelite king, which is dependent and receiving orders from God Almighty himself. And if God was going to call them war, you don't think he knows how many people he has? You don't think he knows what he's going to need to accomplish the purpose he has as the one who's guiding his people? And so he starts acting and relying upon his own strength, and then something beautiful happens. David realizes he sinned greatly against the Lord, but this time without a prophet. Because you guys remember when David sins with Bathsheba, this is the same guy. So David the shepherd, David and Goliath, you know the guy. And then David the king of Israel, and then he sins with Bathsheba. And when he sins with Bathsheba, the Lord has to send Nathan to rebuke him and to call him towards repentance. And here we are later on in his life, and notice the difference. This time it says that his heart struck him. What a beautiful picture of the life of someone who's repentant. Not perfect, but this time it's his heart, and there's no need for the prophet to come rebuke him because his heart realizes that he sinned greatly against the Lord. You need to understand, David wasn't a great king because of all his choices. He was a great king because he was a repentant king. Saul, he confessed his sin when he was caught, but David repented. And so David sins against God, and then God offers David three options for judgment. He says, you can have 3 years of famine, you can have 3 months of being chased by your enemies, by your foes, or you could have 3 days of pestilence. Man, I don't want that from God. I don't want God to give me options on which judgment. Like that, David says he's greatly distressed by that, obviously. Like, I would never want this, but it's so beautiful to see what David's response is actually he decides to put himself in God's hands, meaning, God, you pick. As long as it's you, I'm okay with it. Why? Because I have found you to be merciful, and I have found man not to be merciful. Man is not merciful, yet God is. And so I think what he's doing there, he's removing that option of 3 months of being chased by his enemies. He doesn't want to put himself in man's hands. He wants it to be something from God. And so God's answer is that it's going to be 3 days of pestilence. So then the angel of the Lord is executing the judgment of the Lord, and 3 days of pestilence are coming. And as soon as it starts, 70,000 men die just like that. Like, wow, 70,000 men. So who knows what the total number of people who died is? For sure over 100,000 people, right? Dead, just like that, super fast, as the angel of the Lord is bringing a pestilence to the land of Israel. And then the angel of the Lord shows up at Jerusalem. He's right outside the city. He's right outside the border to bring this judgment of the Lord. And then he pauses. And that's where we jump in. That's verse 18. So you need to understand the tension of what we're talking about here. Here comes the judgment, and you're like, well, maybe he won't do it. Oh, no, he's going to do it. 70,000 men already died. Here comes the angel of the Lord, and he pauses, and in verse 18 says this. And Gad came that day to David. So Gad is David's seer. This is how God communicates to David. And Gad came that day to David and said to him, go up, raise an altar to the Lord on the threshing floor of Araunah the Jebusite. So David went up at Gad's word, as the Lord commanded. And when Araunah looked down, he saw the king and his servants coming on toward him. And Araunah went out and paid homage to the king with his face to the ground. And Araunah said, why has my lord the king come to his servant? David said, to buy the threshing floor from you, in order to build an altar to the Lord, that the plague may be averted from the people. That the plague may be averted from the people. Why are they building this altar? They are seeking the mercy of God. This is where it all begins. And if we're going to build our altar of worship, this is where it starts for us too. We seek the mercy of God. Mercy is when God withholds the thing that we deserve. So as you look into this passage, there is something they deserve. Why? Because the king of Israel had sinned greatly against God, and so they deserve this judgment, and what they're seeking is God's mercy, that God would withhold the things that they deserve. And this is where it starts for us too, as we build our altar of worship. You need to understand that as you worship God, you are seeking the mercy of God. You are asking God, God, please don't give me the things I deserve. Have mercy upon me. And if you are a child of God, God is being merciful to you right now. Do you understand that what we deserve is death? We deserve shame. We deserve condemnation. Those are the things we do deserve. And yet today we get to worship God freely and be in relationship with him. Why? Because of God's mercy. And this is why it starts to make sense why we would enter his gates with thanksgiving. Why thanksgiving? Well, that's because when you come into the presence of God, you acknowledge your need for mercy. You understand that the very fact that we are here today is because of God's mercy. And we begin to build our altar with the acknowledgement of our need for mercy. The greater our sense of need for mercy, the greater our thankfulness to God will be. Because you realize what he's doing, what he's holding back for you. I think this is a little bit harder today to realize sometimes when you look at the people of Israel, they had a much clearer sense of their need for God's mercy. It was just so like crystal clear in their eyes, and they had seen different things than we've seen. They'd seen the Red Sea part. They'd seen the Red Sea swallow up Pharaoh and his chariots. They had seen the earth open up and the sons of Korah be swallowed up. They'd seen many, many visible signs of God's judgment. And you need to understand that we also see signs of God's mercy today by the fact that we're here. Because of what God put on Jesus, that's how we get to enjoy all the awesome things we enjoy as God's children, and that is God's sign of his mercy to you today. So it begins there, seeking the mercy of God. And then this, verse 22, we continue in the passage. Then Araunah said to David, let my lord the king take and offer up what seems good to him. Here are the oxen for the burnt offerings and the threshing sledges and the yokes of the oxen for the wood. All this, O king, Araunah gives to the king. And Araunah said to the king, may the Lord your God accept you. Interesting that may the Lord your God accept you. Parallel between Romans 12, right, that we would be acceptable to God. May the Lord your God accept you. Now, what's going on here? Araunah says, hey, David, here's the land. Here's the threshing floor. You can have it. Well, that doesn't make sense. David actually showed up. We just read that he said, I came to buy it. He said, I came to buy it from Araunah. And then Araunah says, all this, my king, you can just have. Why? Well, put yourself in Araunah's shoes. Like, what if the angel of the Lord is right outside the border of Jerusalem? He's coming to execute this judgment. You're like, let's get this process rolling of building this altar as fast as we can. You can have everything you need. I'll even give you some of the things you need for the actual altar that you're going to build as fat, and he's going to give it to him for free. And then David says, no. Why? Well, it's right there in the passage, verse 24. But the king said to Araunah, no, but I will buy it from you for a price. I will not offer burnt offerings to the Lord my God that cost me nothing. So David bought the threshing floor and the oxen for 50 shekels of silver. I will not offer burnt offerings to the Lord my God that cost me nothing. As we build our altar of worship, we start with seeking the mercy of God. And then the second point, we give of ourselves sacrificially. Give of yourself sacrificially. Not just something that costs you nothing, something that does cost you something. That's the concept of it being sacrificial. Because you need to understand that the heart of a worshiper is not a heart of minimalism. Like, it's not like we come to worship God and we're like, God, what's the bare minimum we have to do to count as your worshipers? That's not the heart of a worshiper. The heart of a worshiper is the exact opposite. God, what more could I give to you? What more could I bring? More of you, less of me. I want to give everything I can. That's the heart of a worshiper, and you're willing to sacrifice because of the one you're sacrificing for. And the heart of a worshiper is not a heart of minimalism, because worship calls you beyond the threshold of your personal preference. It calls you past that. So imagine it this way. Imagine a circle around you, each one of you, and within anything that's within your reach, that would be your preferences. So that means, I do like doing this, I don't like doing this, I'd rather do it this way. This is your personal preference. And you need to understand that worship of God calls you beyond that circle and into new territory, where you stop thinking about what would I like, and you start thinking about what would God want? What are the things God wants from me? And instead of filling your mind with, I like this, I don't like this, like, it, I'm trying to help you here. You will find new freedom if you can get past that threshold. If you can get past the moment of like, I'm only thinking about, do I like this, do I not? What are my thoughts, my thoughts, my thoughts? And stop those thoughts and say, what does God want? What does God want? And that's where worship calls you into that territory. I mean, why do you think the temperature of our worship services is going up? Like, I don't know if you can sense it. I've talked with a bunch of people in our congregation, different campuses, and it's just kind of this thing of like, we don't know exactly what's going on, but something's happening in our worship services. I don't pretend to know everything, but could I just suggest to you, maybe what's going on is that the temperature's going up because it's costing us a little bit more? Because it's costing us a little bit more to sing today than it was last year? I know it's true for me. It's a lot harder for me to get up on stage and to lead God's people in worship than it ever has been. And I just sense God blessing that. And I'm like, why? Because we shouldn't be offering things to God that cost us nothing. It's okay that it costs you something because it's sacrificial. And God wants you to give of yourself sacrificially. So how does that show up in our services? Well, if this is my sacrifice of worship to God, I should probably be here when we give the worship to God. So meaning, if our service is at 10 o'clock, I should probably be in this room to give this sacrifice of worship to God. Now, I get it. That's not super easy all the time. We have 2 kids. They're 6 and 4. And every morning, it's a new adventure. You don't know what you get. And I get it. It's hard. Like, I serve as a worship leader at the Crystal Lake campus, and I live in Elgin. So we got to get the kids up at like 5:30 to get them to rehearsal, because I serve a lot of times with my wife. And so getting those kids up at 5:30, that's not fun for them, and they make sure it's not fun for us sometimes. And it's hard, and that's okay. That's what I'm saying. It's okay that it's hard. It's okay that it costs me something. Why? Because I'm getting up to worship God. And so I want to get to church in time to get my kids checked in, to actually be in this room. Why? To make these people happy? No, no, no. For God. This is my worship of Jesus, and I'm going to make it my priority. So I'm going to show up early, and I'm going to make sure I'm focused, because this is my chance to gather with God's people and lift high the name of Jesus. And I'm not going to just show up early. I'm going to make sure not leave early. So, why? Because I want everything God has for us today. Like, if you set your lunch reservation for today at 11:32, it just might not be the best plan. Like, if you, 11:30, gotta go, run, everybody run. You know, like, it's maybe just set it for noon. Like, it's not that different. Like, you're gonna be okay. And so I understand that there are many things that are inconvenient when it comes to gathering for worship, but what I'm suggesting to you is that it's okay, because you're sacrificing that convenience like David did with Arana. Arana gave it to him for free. That would have been faster, that would have been more convenient, and David says, no, I'm not going to do it that way. Why? Because it needs to cost me something if it's my worship to God. And so it's okay that it costs you something. It's okay that it's inconvenient, because we want to give of ourselves sacrificially when we're building our altar of worship. So let me just give you five offerings of sacrificial worship. There are many more, but for today's time, I'm just going to give you five. And these are things that God has requested from us, so they're very simple, but they can be very profound if you actually do these things that God is asking for. So the first is singing. Psalm 96, verse 1 says, "Oh, sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord all the earth." The word sing there in the Hebrew is the word shir, which just means to sing, so nothing complex to understand there. But then it says, "Sing to the Lord all the earth." So it seems to be that the stipulation on does this verse apply to me would be, do you live on planet Earth? All right? If you want to know if God wants to sing to you, ask yourself, am I standing on planet Earth? And if the answer is yes, the answer is yes, that God wants to sing from you. This is a beautiful thing. Do you realize that the God of the universe who made you, who knows the hairs on your head, who keeps your tears in a bottle, that God wants you to sing to him? That's a beautiful thing. He wants you to sing to him. You know, I'm a pastor's kid, a missionary kid. I grew up in Mexico City, Mexico. My dad's still a pastor there, and I grew up in that church leading worship when I was 15 years old. I got the, like, worship leader job. It was a small church, so there wasn't a lot of interviews for the job. It was just kind of like, hey, you kind of play guitar, you kind of sing. You got the job. Like, go. And I was 15 years old, and that was, like, big church, like this. It wasn't, like, youth group, so I definitely was not ready as a leader. Musically, I don't know, maybe I had a few things that I was ready, but I was not fully ready, and then there was no one really helping me guide, like, here's what God's word says about worship. I had none of that. So I had to learn, you know, trial by fire a bit. And so there I am leading worship as a 15-year-old, and I wasn't super wise, as many 15-year-olds would be. And one of the things that was unwise that I did is I used to, you know, I'd look out as I'm leading worship, and I'd look at my friends, and I'd be like, oh, man, there's my friend, but he's not singing. Well, I should do something about that. Like, we should all be singing. So then I go talk to him after the service, and the reason it's unwise is because I want you guys to know, like, we're not, like, evaluating you every week and, like, have some board in the worship department that we're like, oh, this person's not, like, we don't do any of that stuff. That's not wise. We want to lead you in a way that just calls you to worship, that you would do the things that God wants. We want to exemplify that to you as your worship leaders, and that you would respond to God and not to just us. And so that's why it's unwise, but you need to know back then, and he was my friend, so I guess I had a little bit of permission to go talk to him. So after the service, I talked to him, and I'm like, hey, I noticed you don't sing. Why don't you sing? And his answer was, I don't like singing. It was within the circle of his personal preference, was his answer. And, but then things got a little interesting when a few months later we go to a concert of his favorite band, and he starts singing pretty loud, all right? He's going all out at that concert. Then we go to his cousin's birthday, or his nephew's birthday party, and he's singing happy birthday to that nephew. And I'm like, what? Well, clearly there's some scenario where you think it's appropriate to sing. And so, look, what I'm telling you today is maybe that's you. Maybe you really don't like singing. And what I'm telling you today is you don't have to sing anywhere else. But maybe if there's just one place that you sing, it should be here. It should be for God. Why? Because God wants you to. And worship calls you beyond the threshold of your personal preference. And if you're telling me I don't like to sing, that's okay. But worship calls you past that. And you say, but does God want you to? Because if you live on earth, it's clear he wants you to. God wants this from you. He wants your singing. Not only that, second offering of sacrificial worship, shouting. God wants you to shout. Psalm 66, verse 1 says, shout for joy to God, all the earth. Oh, man, we can't get out of this one either. Shout for joy to God, all the earth. Sing the glory of his name. Give to him glorious praise. That is the word shouting there in Hebrew is the word ruah, which, a little side note, because I'm from Mexico, I speak Spanish. Anytime I have to say something in Hebrew, I just use my Spanish accent, and people think I know what I'm talking about. So it's a fantastic trick. You should use it sometime. So ruah, the word means to cry out greatly, to split the ears with sound. Not 100% sure what that means, but it sounds powerful. To raise the war cry, to cheer, to shout in triumph. To shout in triumph. And I get it, like, we all came from different families. And some are louder families, some are not so loud. So if you were to come to dinner at the Hoagland family at the dinner table, you would have been like, you guys aren't talking. You're just shouting at each other, like nonstop. Like, look at the youngest sibling. He can't even talk. Like, everyone's just yelling and yelling. And that's our family's a little bit more that way. And then you come over here to this family who's so soft-spoken, and I go over to their house for dinner, and it's like we sit down and we're going to pray for the meal, and I can hear the sizzle of the food louder than the prayer that's being said somewhere else around the table. Like, they're just so soft-spoken. So here's what I'm saying. There's nothing wrong with being that family, but even that family, God says, if you're mine, I want you to shout. And not just shout, shout for joy. Like, we're not just screaming for no reason. Shout for joy to God. Like, for joy, there's a reason why you're screaming. Do you understand that if you have Jesus, you win? Like, no matter what you've lost, amen, that's right. No matter what you've lost, if you have Jesus, you win. And you have a reason to shout. Every single one of you has a reason to shout. And God wants you to shout for joy. God wants this from you. Next thing, clapping. All right, God wants us to clap. Psalm 47, verse 1 says, clap your hands, all peoples. Man, do you hear God speaking today? Like, you might be thinking, I'm the exception. Do you hear from God saying, no one's the exception? No one is the exception. Clap your hands, all peoples. Shout to God with loud songs of joy. The word there for clap is the word takah, which means to strike your hands together. The root of the word takah has to do with a trumpet blast. So it's as a trumpet would be like, boom, it could do a blast. That's what we're doing with our hands. Boom, that's a takah. And God's saying, I want takah from my people. Clap your hands, all peoples. So back to the 15-year-old worship leader in Mexico. So we are leading worship, and I had the youth choir behind me, and we were singing this song, We Want to See Jesus Lifted High. Anybody remember that song? This was been like early 2000s. So it was like, we want to see Jesus lifted high, a banner that flies. I'm not seeing a lot of response, so probably not a lot of people know the song, but that's okay. Yeah, some people, well, we'll see how many people know it, because in the chorus, you're supposed to go, we want to see. All right, there's like 15 people. Hey, all right. Yeah, you're supposed to clap three times. We want to see, clap, clap, clap. We want to see, clap, clap. So a lot's changed since the early 2000s. We're not as coordinated with our clapping these days. It's a little bit more freeform. But yeah, so we're leading that song, and I'm like, queremos a Cristo. And you have to understand, in our church, like, my dad's a pastor. He never preached anything like, don't clap, clapping's bad. Never said anything. No worship leader had ever stood on stage and said, don't do that. But if you came to our church and you looked around, you're like, oh yeah, we definitely don't clap here. Like, it was just non-verbal communication. We definitely don't clap in this church. And so we had never clapped, and I'm leading this song, and I got the youth choir behind me, and they're going to clap, right? Because we had rehearsed, so they knew you were supposed to clap. And so I'm singing the verse. I'm like, queremos a Cristo. And I just start sweating bullets. I'm so nervous. I'm like, what's going to happen? Like, we're going to clap for the first time in church ever, and like, everyone's going to leave, and I don't know what's going to happen, you know. And then so we get to the chorus, and I'm just so nervous because I'm consumed by everyone else's preference. I was consumed. It's all I could think about is, what do they think? What do they think? What do they think? And I wasn't thinking, what does God say? What does God say? What does God say? And this is why it was unwise to do it the way I was doing it. You don't just start doing things in church and hope people, like, grab on. Like, you should do what we're doing now, where I'm showing you within God's word what it says. Why is that a big deal? Because if I don't show people in God's word that God is the one who wants clapping, then people will make the mistake of thinking it's a fad. Like, oh, this is just going to come and go. Like, certain things come and go in church world. It's just a fad. It's not forever. Or even worse, you might think it's generational. You might think that clapping is just for a certain age group. And that is not great. Why? Because God never told us that. He said, clap your hands, all peoples. And you need to understand that what God is blessing every generation is the generation doing the things God has requested. I don't see God blessing a style of music. I don't see God blessing a certain instrument a special way. What I see God doing is blessing his word. I see him do it over and over again, that the more things we do that God has asked of us, you just watch him. You just watch him. And you're like, yeah, but it's hard. I'm not like that. It's not. It calls you beyond the threshold of your personal preference. And start thinking about, does God want this? All right, so singing, shouting, clapping. Next, dancing. Ooh, got controversial now. You can't talk about dancing. What are you talking about, Eddie? Well, I can talk about dancing because God talks about dancing. Psalm 149, verse 3 says, "Let them praise his name with dancing, making melody to him with the tambourine and lyre." Don't be fooled by the tense of that verse in the ESV. "Let them praise his name" is not like, if you'd like to, let them, you know, like just like a permission thing. No, a better way of saying it is, may it be so. Let it be so that they praise his name with dancing. This is something God wants, and it's the word machol. The word machol means to twist or whirl, to dance, including physical movements of various sorts, a joyful trembling in worship. A joyful trembling in worship. Now, notice it says, including physical movements of various sorts. So it's not like, it's not like there's a version of the Macarena God's like, that's worship. You know, like, there's not like moves to worship that God had prescribed to us. He just says, including physical movements of various sorts. So what he's going after is that it's not static. Like, there's motion inside. That's the dancing, the whirling, the twisting, all these words that he gives to us. You know, when you're studying a word in the Hebrew, one of the most useful tools is to actually go back to the root of the word and see what other words are connected to the word that you're studying, to see what else can I study about this the meaning, the exact meaning of this. And the root of the word machol has a negative application, and it means writhing as with pain. And so this is very helpful for me to start thinking about. It's the negative version of this word. Writhing as with pain, the root also speaks to labor pains, right? Like bearing a child and what that pain is. And since I will never know what that is, I have to come up with what is writhing as with pain for Eddie. For me, that's stubbing my toe. That is writhing as with pain. Because when we moved here 9 years ago, we moved here and we didn't have a bed, so we had to go get a bed. So we go over to Schaumburg, go to IKEA, big blue building. We're like, here we are. IKEA's great. You spend like $250, $300. You get this queen-size bed. But what they don't tell you is that you buy the bed, and then you have to spend 8 hours of a day to build said bed. And then after 8 hours of assembling the bed, then you have to spend another hour going backwards in the steps to find that little wooden peg you put in the wrong place. And so you have to fix your mistake. And then you finally get to have a bed. So you build your bed, and it's super modern. It looks awesome. You're like, oh, this is so cool. It's like Sweden's amazing. And you're just like, this is great. But because it's so modern, it's not very clear like where it starts, where it ends. And then on top of that, they make the trap of like the comforter goes over the edges. It's a trap. Like they want you to hit your toe on the corner. And so I'm walking by the bed, and I'm like, I'm pretty sure I'm supposed to sleep there. And so I'm walking towards it, and then boom, I stub my toe. And I've seen different people react to that different ways. Some people, they stub their toe and they just start running in circles. Like, just running in circles. I'm a bit more introverted. I might be like, if I stub my toe, I'm like, and I like lean over and I like enter into the fetal position. That's just more my personality. Because when I stub my toe, it's not like, oh, my toe hurts. No, it's Eddie hurts. Eddie is hurting right now. Everything about me is pain because the pain is so great that I cannot stay still. Because the pain is so great that I cannot stay still. And could it be that the joy of the Lord would get to be so great as you think about his favor, as you think of his faithfulness, and you give testimony to yourself of how good God is, as you think of that, could the joy get to be so great that you just can't stay still? Like, I can't just say, hey, worship, time to worship God. Left foot here, right foot here. You guys better not move. You better not move until the worship sets up. Like, could it be that there's just motion, that it doesn't feel so static, that you could take a step forward, you could take a step back. Whatever motion there could be, because God, the joy of the Lord could be so great that you just can't stay still. And if God wants that, I want to give that to him. And then finally, raising of hands. Psalm 143, verse 6 says, I stretch out my hands to you. My soul thirsts for you like a parched land, Selah. The word there is paras, which just means to spread out or stretch over. I stretch out my hands to you. My soul thirsts for you like in a parched land. Clearly, meaning a need, like what we sang today. Lord, I need you. It's an expression of need. And maybe you're in that parched land today. Maybe you're in the dry land. And could it be that what God's inviting you to do is that you would stretch out your hands to him and say, God, I need you. And it doesn't just have to mean that. Another psalm tells us, lift up your hands to the holy place and bless the Lord. So it can just be an expression of blessing. God, I'm lifting my hands for you. So if you can imagine, I grew up in a church that didn't shout, didn't clap. There wasn't any raising of hands. And side note, this church is a completely different church now. It's been awesome to see how they've grown in worship as well, if you were to ever visit them. But I'd never raised my hands. And then I went to Liberty University for college, and I'm studying worship because the Lord had called me to ministry. And I'd never raised my hands, and then I start reading these verses, and I'm like, well, there it is. Like, I got to do something about this. And so I decided one day, I'm going to raise my hands today in worship. And I went to class, and because it's worship class, they would lead us in worship at the start of class. So I go to class, and I knew I was going to do it that day, and I sit in the back row. You better believe I sat in the back row. And they start leading us in worship, and I was starting to think, like, well, when am I supposed to, like, what's the rules here? You know, one hand, two hands, like, out, up, what am I supposed to do here? And I just sense the Lord's being like, Eddie, like, just stop thinking about it, like, just raise your hands, like, just do it in obedience. And so I was like, okay. So I never felt anything special, and I was just like, and they're up, you know, like, all right, we made it this far. And there I am, and I just got to tell you, like, it wasn't special in regards to my experience that day, but it was deeply special in regards to my obedience of Christ that day. And now, I mean, now I can't worship God with my hands. Like, it's so natural to me because I want to bless the Lord and I want to express my need to him. Like, that's not a difficult thing, but it started difficult because it wasn't inside of my threshold of personal preference to do that. So these are the things God asks of us so that we would give of ourselves sacrificially. And then finally, the last verse of the book, and we'll close here. Last verse of 2 Samuel chapter 24 and of the book, verse 25. And David built there an altar to the Lord and offered burnt offerings and peace offerings. So the Lord responded to the plea for the land, and the plague was averted from Israel. And the plague was averted from Israel. We seek the mercy of God. We give of ourselves sacrificially. And then this, we get to see the response of the Lord. We get to see the response of the Lord. Now, we don't get to decide the response of the Lord. You need to understand that. I'm not telling you today that if you do these five things, then you get to tell God what he needs to do in your life, what plague needs to be averted. That's not how it works. You don't get to decide the outcome, but guess what? You get to see God do it. And he's the only one that should be trusted with the outcome. He's the only one who should be telling us exactly and guiding us, because he has all knowledge. And the plague was averted from the people of Israel. That's what God did. The plague was averted. And if you are a child of God today, you need to know a plague has been averted for you as well. When I was studying this passage, I honestly did not understand what I was studying. And then in my study, it just like hit me like a ton of bricks what was happening. This is the buying of the threshing floor where David buys it from Araunah and seeks the mercy of God, and an altar is built and the plague is averted. And this very same piece of land is where Abraham took Isaac. And he took him up, and then God offers a substitution. And then years later, David buys a threshing floor and God offers mercy. And then David gets all the materials together and he gives them to his son Solomon. And where do they build the temple? Right there. This floor would become the Temple Mount where the glory of God would dwell. And then the Son of God would enter through that gate. And then they would take him outside the city and they would sacrifice him. And that is what all altars, all sacrifices were pointing towards anyways. It was a temporary atonement for the ultimate payment for our sins, which would be Jesus Christ. And sometimes when we study God's word and looking at the Old Testament, you can kind of feel distant from it. And I understand that there's certain things specifically in Levitical ceremonial law that we don't observe today because they're fulfilled today. Jesus didn't come to abolish the law. He came to fulfill the law. And you need to understand what we have in common, because today we approach God with a priest. You need to know that. We approach God with a priest, not just with a priest, but with a high priest. And not just with a high priest, but with a great high priest. For Hebrews chapter 4 says, therefore, since we have a great high priest who has ascended into heaven, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to the faith we profess, for we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with our weaknesses. But we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet he did not sin. Let us then approach God's throne of grace with confidence, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. We worship today with a high priest, and today we worship with a sacrifice that was offered to God. It's like when John the Baptist sees Jesus coming, he says, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. The perfect sacrifice. And today we get to worship God because of that sacrifice and because he is our great high priest. And so therefore I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, I appeal to you, Harvest Bible Chapel, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship, that you would seek the mercy of God, that you would give of yourself sacrificially, and that you would see the response of the Lord. So the question is, how can you grow as a sacrificial worshiper? Because you need to understand that as I went through and as I started talking through some of these things, I know how it goes. Like, you start hearing a voice in your head that's just saying, you know what, you're just bad at worship. Like, this isn't you. This is a message for someone else. You're just never going to be good at this. And I want to encourage you, don't listen to that voice. There's another voice that was saying, hey, maybe this one thing you could get better at today. And I want you to listen to that voice and say, okay, maybe I can't change everything, but maybe just this one thing. Just this one thing, God, I've never sung to you, and I want to obey what you have asked from me. And just this one thing, I've never raised my hand, I've never done this because of all these reasons, but God, if you'll give me the chance, I want to obey you. Do you understand that God's your Father? Like, he loves you. He wants you to grow, amen. He wants you to grow, and so he's not trying to reveal these things to you to make you feel shame. He reveals it to you as a sign of grace, so that you could grow. What father would look down upon a child learning how to walk, and as that child trips and falls, the father would be like, what's wrong with you? What's wrong with you? Why aren't you walking better? That's not God. God's your Father. He's saying, I'm glad you're learning. I'm glad you're doing something about it. And so today, that's my invitation to you. Just think of, what is it that God wants you to grow in? So go ahead and close your eyes, bow your heads, and just spend time with the Lord right now. Say, God, here's what's on my heart. Here's what I sense you calling me to. And tell him that you're willing. Ask him for the opportunity. Father, we thank you today for our great high priest who can empathize with what we walk through and yet who can stand in your presence and in so doing offer us access to your presence. Thank you for Jesus, who was a sacrifice, who actually pays the price for the sins that we have committed. May that thankfulness lead to praise today, God. You are so good to us. No matter what we're staring right into this week, we know that you are good, that your plans are good, that you want to prosper us. You know what you're doing. No matter what we face, no matter what we see, we know that you know what you're doing. And that's why we want to respond to you here today in the way that you've asked us to respond. It's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.